Good morning. I'm Melissa Harris-Perry. Over the past few weeks, an important public debate has been taking place online about race, culture, and poverty. Now, the principals are two very smart people who write for two well-regarded magazines. This is Jonathan Chait, a writer for New York Magazine, a self-professed liberal who writes about politics and media. This is Ta-Nehisi Coates, national correspondent for The Atlantic. Now, I should disclose that he once described me as America's foremost public intellectual, which was not only an overstatement, but also a designation far more descriptive of the prolific Coates himself. So those are the interlocutors, and here is what sparked the debate. This is Congressman Paul Ryan on March 12th.
We have got this tailspin of culture in our inner cities in particular, of men not working, and just generations of men not even thinking about working or learning the value and the culture of work. And so there's a real culture problem here that has to be dealt with.
The backlash to Ryan's comments was swift. Congresswoman Barbara Lee described them as a thinly veiled racial attack, and progressive commentators pointed to the hypocrisy of Ryan's insistence on cultural explanations for poverty while advancing policies that deepen inequality. And as is frequently the case, Ta-Nehisi Coates on March 18th made a contribution to this discussion that was especially insightful. He pointed to the discursive similarities between Congressman Ryan's culture statement and President Obama's repeated invocations of Cousin Pookie when talking to black audiences about how to lessen inequality. Now, Coates was less interested in lambasting this president in particular than in reminding us about the slippery assumptions about blackness, poverty, and cultural deficiency that are ubiquitous. White conservatives do this pathologizing, of course. Just look at Congressman Ryan. White liberals do it. See President Clinton's determination to end welfare as we knew it. Black conservatives do it. Just look at the new black conservative magazine, American Current C, whose stated mission is, quote, transcending race through delivering the awareness of a culture free of government dependency. As Coates was pointing out, even black liberals tend to conflate poverty with pathology, even President Obama. Here's the president announcing the My Brother's Keeper initiative in February, a program designed to remove the structural obstacles to success for young men of color.
Yes, we need to train our workers, invest in our schools, make college more affordable, and government has a role to play. And yes, we need to encourage fathers to stick around and remove the barriers to marriage and talk openly about things like responsibility and faith and community. In the words of Dr. King, it is not either or, it is both and.
So, are you still with me? Conservative congressman invokes culture of poverty. Progressives cry foul. Smart cultural observer points out that the president is sometimes guilty of the same strategy. On March 19th, enter Jonathan Chait, who responded to Coates' piece by defending the idea that culture is, at least in part, responsible for the perpetuation of African-American poverty. He wrote, "It would be bizarre to imagine that centuries of slavery, followed by systematic terrorism, segregation, discrimination, a legacy wealth gap, and so on, did not leave a cultural residue that itself became an impediment to success." Coates then responded, quote, Chait believes it's bizarre to think otherwise. I think it's bizarre that he doesn't bother to see his argument as if it's actually true. Oppression might well produce a culture of failure. It might also produce a warrior spirit and a deep commitment to attaining the very things which had been so often withheld from you. There is no need for theorizing. The answers are knowable. And that is when it started to get good. Chait, March 28th, Barack Obama versus the culture of poverty. Coates, March 30th, other people's pathologies. Chait, March 31, Ta-Nehisi Coates disagrees with Jonathan Chait, and so do I. Coates, April 1, the blue period, an origin story. And so on. I mean, man, nerdalicious, good. Wickedly smart people using enormous words, complex sentence structures, and thinly veiled intellectual shade to discuss consequential issues. And it wasn't happening in some college lecture hall. People were paying attention. Writers at The Nation, The American Prospect, The New York Times all jumped in to tap out Coates or Chait and get their own licks in. Heck, even Gawker covered it. Now, call that a win for public democratic deliberation. But as much as I eagerly anticipated each new entry in this thoroughly engrossing conversation, it was also disappointing. Many times in American history, African Americans have entered multiracial progressive political coalitions only to discover that even those who were supposed to be political allies are eager to argue there is something inherently, residually wrong with black people. Far less frequently do impoverished black folks find a public ally among the intelligentsia, willing and able to assert without qualification their humanity, dignity, and absolute worthiness. Coates has done so unwaveringly, and watching it happen in real time has been stunning. I am pleased to welcome to the table Ta-Nehisi Coates, national correspondent for The Atlantic. And I'd also like to note here that we did invite Jonathan Chait as well, but he was not available to come on the show today. Ta-Nehisi, nice to have you here.
Thanks for having me, Melissa.
So this has really taken on a very high level of sort of public interest. To what do you attribute that at this moment, given that you write about these kinds of things regularly? Why has this captured public attention?
I actually don't know. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I never know what's going to catch fire and what's not going to catch fire. But I think there is a deep, deep presumption across the board in America that there is something culturally wrong with people who are poor, and specifically with African Americans. And I think that's accepted wisdom right now for whatever reason. Barack Obama, whenever he makes that statement, whenever the president does that sort of speech, he always gets applause.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's very...
From African American audience.
From African American audience. Mm-hmm. And by across the board, I mean even among African Americans. Yep. And I think people think it's a little bizarre when you say, no, it's not culture at all. Mm-hmm. It's not culture at all.
So part of how Chait begins his conversation with you in his response back is he returns actually to a piece that you wrote in October of 2010, where you talk about basically, I think, what we would describe as code switching, learning that the sets of tools that you had in one space are not appropriate tools or effective tools to use in another.
Right.
What is it that you think Chait misunderstood about what you were trying to say in that piece?
Well, his argument, and this is the argument, you know, across the board, is that this is cultural residue. In other words, there's something that happened in the past that has nothing to do with what you're going through right now, and you're, you know, bringing that forward, be it generational, be it in a past life. When I had that incident, I was living in Harlem. I was, I think, about 6 months removed from unemployment. Mm-hmm. I had just, you know, lost a job. I actually didn't have a job at that point, even when I was out there freelance writing. I was living within the environment where that behavior would have been appropriate. There was nothing residual about it at all.
Mm-hmm.
It just so happened where I was working,
mm-hmm.
it was clearly not appropriate.
Right.
And, you know, that's a lesson that, you know, folks have to learn. I'm totally in favor with teaching that lesson, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
I do think people need to learn that certain behaviors are appropriate one place and certain behaviors, you know, are not appropriate other places. But this is not residue. White supremacy is not residue. It's a real lived thing for African Americans.
All right, I want to talk about that discourse of white supremacy because it is one of the important pushbacks that you give to the cultural pathology mm-hmm. argument. So what is at stake for you intellectually and politically to say that what we face in terms of questions of continuing racial inequality needs to be ascribed to continuing white supremacy, and help us to understand what you mean when you say that, versus a cultural residue among African Americans?
Well, I think part of the problem is that liberals and progressives, when we talk about this, we have this idea that we were racist in the past and we are suffering after effects. But what academics know, I mean, you can, you know, go out and look at the studies and you see young African Americans who are looking for low-wage jobs have about the same chance of getting a job as a white person with a felony on their record. I mean, when we see things like this, this is a thing that's happening right now. A really, really small number of people on the planet Earth are African American males, and yet 8% of the incarcerated population mm-hmm. on the planet Earth is African American and male. Mm-hmm. You can't separate those two things out. This is happening right now.
So okay, but let's go to that, because so I love the piece of social science research you just told us. That's Diva Page's research
exactly.
in Marked, that if employers are looking at a resume of an African American without a felony and a white applicant with a felony.
You're so sharp. You stated the study. Wow.
Well,
that's why you're America's foremost intellectual.
No. I'm just a nerd, right?
Wow.
So the idea that we see like decisions being made in employment right now.
Right.
But when you say the piece about incarceration, right, that's the kind of data point that is simply a data point, right?
Right.
So you have mass incarceration.
Right.
But then what happens is precisely this ability to have a conversation about, well, why then?
Right.
Is it because of criminality, heightened criminality among African American men? Or is it because of heightened policing among African American men?
Right.
How would we, because you say the answers are knowable.
Right.
How would we begin to know those answers?
Well, I think like one of the regrettable things is there's a great disconnect I would say specifically with historians, but I think this goes across the board in terms of the academy and people over here who write about it in the press. Mm-hmm. And I would like to see more of a convergence, more of a conversation back and forth. Because oftentimes when I talk to social scientists, when I talk to historians, they know the answers. I mean, it's not really blurry for them at all. So if I make the statement that white supremacy is at the core of American history and will likely be a problem with us until the end of our days, if I tell a group of historians that that's water is wet. Mm-hmm. It's not a remarkable statement. And yet out mm-hmm. here, for some reason, it's like, you know, stunning to say that.
So do you think it's a great debate or a dumb debate that we're having? In other words, you know, I've framed this is the great debate of our moment, but yeah. should we even be debating this?
Yes. Okay. And, you know, as much as I disagree with Jonathan, I really appreciate him engaging me on it. I think Jonathan is a fantastic writer, and I'm happy to do this. Yeah. You know, I really, really am. I appreciate him jumping in.
Yeah, you do. The two of you certainly do perform a certain level of respectful discourse, and mm-hmm. even to the extent that you throw shade on each other, it's always intellectual. When we come back, I am going to ask you a little bit about, you do this French performance thing that I think is fascinating. When we come back, Ta-Nehisi, stay with us for just a minute. We're going to bring more voices in.